So the title of my sermon this morning is Always With Us. Anyone recognize where that phrase comes from? Where does it come from?
Jesus said it.
It's a story that occurs, that's absolutely right. It's a story that occurs in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It takes place a day or so before Jesus' procession into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. Jesus is staying at a home on the outskirts of Jerusalem, and an unnamed woman offers him hospitality by breaking a jar of expensive perfume and anointing his head with that rich scent. The disciples witness this, and they begin to scold and criticize the woman, telling her, "What a waste! That perfume could have been sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor." But Jesus intervenes, coming to the woman's defense and saying, "The poor you will always have with you, but you will not always have me." Who's found this passage to be a bit problematic? It's a problematic passage in the Bible. It's a passage that has been misinterpreted and misused. It's a passage that has been used to justify abusive conduct and to justify ignoring the poor and the needy. Using passages from the Bible for nefarious purposes is nothing new. The Bible, after all, was used to support slavery, the oppression of women, and to harm lesbians and gays. In just the past couple of days, just the past 48 hours, we've seen the Bible used to attempt to justify the sexual abuse of children. Speaking here of those who are attempting to defend Alabama Senate candidate Roy Moore's pattern of predation towards teenage girls, I like what William Barber said on Friday. He said, quote, "The Alabama auditor's bizarre read on the Holy Family reveals the twisted logic of slaveholder religion. If you read the Bible to justify hurting the people that Jesus loved, you can no longer see the good news for anyone. If you read the Bible to justify hurting the people that Jesus loved, you can no longer see the good news for anyone." And this passage where Jesus says, "The poor you will always have with you," has been misinterpreted in harmful ways. It's a passage that has been used to justify the tolerance of poverty in our society, to excuse ignoring the sufferings of the poor. It has been used as a way to say, well, since we'll never be able to get rid of poverty, we really shouldn't bother to concern ourselves with poor people anyways. It's been used to normalize, to desensitize us to children who go to bed hungry, who work in sweatshops, who shiver through cold nights when the heat gets turned off. But of course, there is a better, truer, and more historically and academically accurate interpretation of this problematic passage, as there usually is. An historically more accurate interpretation of this passage, an interpretation that is actually brings it in line with the rest of the good news. To understand this passage in which Jesus says, "The poor you will always have with you," the first thing we need to understand is that the phrase that Jesus speaks would have had a very specific meaning in his cultural context. When he says, "The poor you will always have with you," anyone who would have heard him would have heard more than that. For example, if I say to you, "Sticks and stones," you know what I'm saying to you, right? You know I'm saying, you can say it along with me, "Sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never hurt me," right? If I say to you, "You can lead a horse to water," you all hear, "You can lead a horse to water, but you cannot make it drink," right? So what if I were to tell you that when Jesus said, "The poor you will always have with you," he was actually referring to a passage from the Torah that everyone who would have heard him would have immediately recognized, because this passage from the Torah would have been recited regularly in the Jewish tradition. And so let's see what the whole passage says. In Deuteronomy, it's written, If among you one of your brothers should become poor in any of the towns within your land that the Lord your God is giving you, you shall not harden your heart or shut your hand against your poor brother, but you shall open your hand to him and lend him sufficient for his need, whatever it may be. For the poor you will always have with you in the land. Therefore, I command you, you shall open wide your hand to your brother, to the needy and to the poor in your land. You shall open your hand. Say that with me. Open wide your hand. Okay, now lightning is not going to strike you if you say words from Deuteronomy. So let's try that again. Open wide your hand.
Open wide your hand.
When Jesus rebuked his disciple, he was not saying forget about the poor. Let's be clear about this. When Jesus rebuked his disciple, he was not saying forget about the poor. No, it was actually a critique of his disciples' stinginess and the scarcity of his thought. Open wide your hand. Jesus preached a liberal gospel, and I mean liberal in the literal meaning of the word, meaning abundant. This is a saying of abundance. Open wide your hand. And what the disciple was beginning to do was something we're familiar with because we see it all the time in our current discourse. We do what that disciple did. That disciple was beginning to make distinctions and to set limits. You know those distinctions, right? We can help the deserving poor, but let's not help the undeserving poor. And Jesus says, no, open wide your hand. We can give out bread, but it can't be good bread. It has to be a little hard, a little stale, and no butter because we don't want to encourage dependence. No, open wide your hand. That's foolishness. Open wide your hand. And what I'm speaking about here, the disciple did, what I'm speaking about here is the human capacity to form and to justify patterns of thinking that are bizarre and lazy. How great is our capacity for self-deception, for rationalization, for self-justification? How great is our capacity for dehumanization, for objectification, for victim blaming? How easily we countenance foolishness, tolerate destructiveness, accept what we should find utterly acceptable? How often do we normalize? Do we think normal and acceptable conditions that are not? The poor you will always have with you is one of those sayings that's been used in an intellectually lazy way to attempt to justify or rationalize what we ought to find morally indefensible. The Briton at the beginning of the Victorian era that you'll see presented here at the community church this coming weekend treated poverty in a way that was cruel and mean. There was a perverted logic at play in the history of the British poor law, and the logic of it went something like this. The reason we have poverty, they reasoned, is that we have made it too comfortable to be poor. And so if we crack down on poor people and make their lives absolutely miserable and stigmatize and shame them, then the poor people will decide not to be poor. They'll get sick of it and choose not to be. And that was really the logic of these laws. For example, in England, the Vagabonds and Beggars Act of 1494 criminalized begging and also criminalized travel without an employer's permission. So the punishment for being caught outside of the workplace was 3 days and nights in the stocks. Similarly, the Victorian workhouses functioned not as a source of relief, but as an instrument of punishment and shame. According to one article I read on Dickens England, by the time that Dickens wrote Oliver Twist, the only source of poor relief was provided by the workhouse. And the poor lived in perpetual fear of being forced through misfortune or infirmity to accept the intentionally harsh conditions within its walls. These anxieties were so prominent in the minds of the Victorian working class that threats of the workhouse were frequently used to compel children to obedience and inspire employees to diligence. The article continues, because the authors of the new poor law believed that any steps should be taken to dissuade the poor from seeking aid from the parish, The living conditions of the workhouse were intentionally harsher than those endured by the poorest of laborers. In fact, workhouse inmates were reputedly treated worse than convicted prisoners. So when I read Marilynne Robinson's essay describing the dehumanizing cruelties of those laws and her account of the mindlessness of those who would destroy the planet in the name of progress, I could not help but see some very obvious parallels to our society here in present-day America. Another of my favorite writers is Tim Wise, and his most recent book is entitled Under the Affluence, subtitled Shaming the Poor, Praising the Rich, and Sacrificing the Future of Our Nation. Tim Wise begins each chapter by invoking the literature of Dickens and then applying it to what we see today. And indeed, there is much in our society today that we would call downright Dickensian. There are no longer literal stocks in the town square for the public shaming of the indigent, but there are all sorts of ways that the poor are shamed and humiliated. There may no longer be the workhouses as they were in the Victorian era, but there are, aren't there, by some reports at any given time, 500,000 Americans in jail, not because they're convicted of a crime, but because they stand accused and cannot afford to post bail? Tell me that our prisons aren't workhouses where the poor are imprisoned and forced to labor. They would recognize these as the same conditions of Britain in the 1830s. Charles Dickens, his family, was born in a fairly middle-class, secure family, but his family, while he was growing up, did have a taste of life on the other side of the tracks. When Charles Dickens was in his early teen years, his father did time in a debtor's prison. And while his father was incarcerated, Charles left school and went to work in a dilapidated, rat-infested factory where he labeled bottles of shoe polish for 6 shillings a week. Dickens was moved by this experience of his own child labor, and so attempted to influence the conscience of his nation, to change the mental patterns concerning poverty through the writing of fictional stories meant to stir the conscience. And so our work remains today. Our work remains to fulfill that biblical injunction to open wide our hands. To open wide our hands to all of our siblings in need. Our work continues to challenge lazy ways of thinking that tell us that the world as it is the world as it must be, that rationalizes, justifies, excuses, and victim blames for the world being as it is. We must challenge ways of thinking that cover immoral situations under the fabric of civility, that causes what is barbaric to be thought of as civilization and culture. Open wide your hand, open wide your mind. Amen and amen. Our closing hymn this morning is one of my favorite. It's number 298, Wake Now My Senses. And I do want to put in a final plug for coming to see all of your fellow congregants, all of your fellow community members in Oliver this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Let us sing together. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit.
Can I say that?